try that again. You know what? And I will correct myself. Good afternoon! Let's have us a contest. And to introduce everything, we have, from Millennium Park Toastmasters, a member since July of 2010, competent communicator, Melanie Bird.
Out there. I just came in from New Jersey myself, you know? And I've been working actually on something because what Melanie didn't know was that she put on a bad Jamaican accent. Well, actually, I got something that gives me a really bad Irish accent, and it's, you may not be able to see it from the back of the room, but I take this every morning. It's an instant Irish accent mouth spray. And look at the effect that it has. Amazing. Look at this lyrical Irish brogue. Well, welcome everyone to the International Speech Competition for this evening. And we're going to have an excellent competition. We have a limited amount of time. In fact, we've got about as much time as a Kim Kardashian marriage. So we're going to be in and out of this competition within 90 minutes. So we'll move it along quite fast. The first thing we want to do is that, and I'm actually going to walk off the stage in a second and do this myself also. I want everyone to take out their cell phone, please, and make sure it is turned off. And I'm actually going to do that myself because I think I've turned mine off, but I'm not 100% sure. So don't go away. Melody, I've got a phone call here from your cousin Everton. Do you want to take him? Okay, all right. Okay, so we have, thank you for taking the time to take your phones out and turn off because you know how annoying it can be. What we're going to do is we have got six excellent contestants. They have all been briefed. What I will now do is I will give you the speaking order. After I've given you the speaking order, I'll invite each of the contestants up. We don't provide an introduction, as you're probably aware, just name, speech title, and name. And after each contestant has spoken, we will ask you to allow 1 minute of silence for the judges to be able to mark their ballots. At the end of the judging, we will give the judges all the time they need to finalise their ballots, and then we will invite the contestants up for brief interviews. So the speaking order is contestant number one, Eric Feinendagen. Eric Feinendagen. Speaker number two, contestant number two, Hugh Dunbar. Contestant number two, Hugh Dunbar. Contestant number three, Greg Thompson. Contestant number three, Greg Thompson. Contestant number four, Gary Behrens, B-E-H-R-E-N-S. Gary Behrens, contestant number four. Contestant number five, Prez Vasilev. Contestant number five, Prez, it's down in your brochure as Prezian Vasilev. And contestant number six is Barry Mixon. So we all ready to rock?
Yes.
We ready to roll?
Yes.
Well, bless my soul. Let's go with the District 30 International Speech Competition. And we wish all of the contestants well. Your first speaker, Eric Feinendagen, the new normal. The new normal, Eric Feinendagen.
And then a child came along, and now I had to juggle three. a family. And then I became our club DPE. And juggling that, well, not so easy. Master Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, and honored guests. For many of us, life is like a juggling act. We're trying to juggle and balance the successes and failures of our past with the commitments and obligations of the present, with our hopes and dreams of the future. Or in other words, we're just quite busy. And we might be able to manage this for a while, but eventually, we're gonna drop the ball. And as we reach down to pick up the balls, sometimes we can lose our balance. And our juggling acts can turn into drama. So the question is, how do we find our balance? Now, to get an answer to this deep and philosophical question, I decided to turn to a higher power. This is a power that is much greater than my own, and I know will always be there for me. This power, of course, are my 300 friends on Facebook. As you can imagine, I didn't get the answer I was looking for. But I definitely needed one, because not too long ago, I fell out of balance. It was 1:45 p.m. on a Wednesday afternoon. I was sitting in my office when I received a phone call from a very good friend and mentor of mine named Gail. She said, "Eric, I need a favor. I have to do a training for a very important client of mine, but I'm double booked. Could you fill in for me?" I said, "You know what, Gail, I'd love to, but I think I'm busy." She said, "Well, that's too bad, because they're willing to pay $1,500 for 3 hours of work." Like I said, Gail, I'm wide open. When you need me. And I took the job. I spent the next 3 months preparing. This could make or break my career. So I walked into that training, full of knowledge, ready to serve. And I walked out, having dropped the ball. In fact, the reviews were so bad that I got better feedback on my icebreaker speech. It threw me way out of balance. But not because I had failed, but imagine how I felt knowing that I let down a friend who had trusted me. Desperate to regain my balance, I decided to meet with a business coach named Dan. And he said, "Eric, balance begins in your mind." He said, "Think of it like a scale. You need to offset the experiences of your past with the opportunity for more in the future. Or in other words, you need to let go to grow." Now, that actually didn't make me feel any better, because raise your hand if you've ever had to let go of something before. It can be scary, right? Because when we let go, we lose control. But he went on to say that we need to get rid of the junk and debris that builds up in our minds that keeps us down and weighs us up, keeps us out of balance. We need to get rid of the what-ifs, the doubts, the failure mentality to create room for future success. This, he said, must be your new normal. So the question I'd like you to consider this afternoon is, are you out of balance? Is there something that you need to let go of? Could there be something in your past that's not allowing you to fully live in the present? Reminds me of a story of a young girl who was born into poverty in the Deep South. Despite her meager surroundings and the fact that she was abused by members of her family, she made a decision that one day she was going to make a difference. So she enrolled in a university and made a commitment that she would positively impact the lives of others. She fulfilled that commitment so much that today she's known by one name, Oprah. She has admitted in her autobiography that because she was willing to let go of the negative experiences of her childhood, she was able to find the balance in her life and create her new normal. She has been quoted as saying, "We become what we dwell on." So again, I ask you, is there something that you need to let go of? You know, it takes me back to my own journey. in the paths that I took in pursuit of my own dreams. I remember the first road I went down. I wanted to play professional basketball in the NBA. Oh, it's okay to laugh, because it's 5 feet, 8 inches tall. Okay, fine, 5 feet, 6 and 3/4, but just keeping track. I had many obstacles. And that goal of mine became dream roadkill. Not wanting to give up, I started another journey. I wanted to be CFO of a Fortune 500 company. So as I went along that journey, I had some success. But you know what? Other people wanted to be CFO too. I hit more obstacles. And that aspiration became more dream roadkill. So like most people, I picked up my broken dreams and I carried them with me. It wasn't until I heard those encouraging words from Dan that I was willing to let go of those broken dreams, regain my balance, and open myself up to new ones, thus creating my new normal. So I'd like to leave you with this. If your life becomes a juggling act, just please remember that sometimes you need to let go to find your balance. You know what's interesting? If you juggle the letters in balance, and you take a C, an A, and an N, and an A, a B, an L, and an E, you'll notice that you can, and you're able to create your new normal. Master Toastmasters.
Eric, if you would give 1 minute of silence, please, for the judges. Thank you, Mr. Tyler. Our next contestant, Hugh Dunbar, proud to be an American. Proud to be an American, Hugh Dunbar.
Mr. Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, distinguished judges, guests. I've always been proud to be an American, proud of my country, what it stands for, its achievements. America is an exceptional country. During the bicentennial in 1976, my oldest daughter was then 4 years old. One morning, I was driving her and all her friends to the swimming pool, and there was an animated conversation in the back seat of the car about how great America is. And my daughter said, and I'll never forget this, now remember, she's 4 years old, and this is the 200th anniversary of the founding of our great nation. She said, every morning I wake up, I say, happy birthday, America. She had every right and reason to be proud of her country. America is the first country in history founded on an ideal. We believe that all men are created equal, that all people are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights. Among them, life, liberty, the pursuit of happiness. Prior to our country, nations were founded on blood. That's one's nationality. But from the very beginning of the United States, the doors of citizenship were flung wide open to anyone willing to come here, work hard, forge a new life. That legacy is the legacy of all Americans. whether we are newly naturalized Americans or whether we are descendants of families that have lived here for generations. Everyone in this room, every one of us, have more in common with each other than we do with our ancestors, no matter where they came from. We are all more American than anything else. My mother was a naturalized American. She came from Canada to the United States when she was a young woman. And during the summers of the 1950s, my brothers and I would go up to my uncle's farm in Ontario, Canada to work. Now, kids being kids, we used to get in arguments with our many, many, many Canadian cousins about whose country was better, Canada or the United States. Well, one day, one of these discussions threatened to boil over to create an international incident. But my grandmother got involved. She calmed everybody down and had us all shake hands with each other. And after we all apologized for the rude things we said to one another, she took me aside. She told me this. My grandmother loved her country. She loved Canada as much as I love the United States. But she said this to me. Always stand up for your country. Always defend the United States of America. I always have, never forgotten it. There are essentials that make America great. Liberty, as established in the Declaration of Independence. Freedom from oppressive government power. Unfettered religious freedom. And the right to speak out for what we believe in. As well as the right to speak out what we're opposed to. How deep felt is the American dedication to individual liberty? This deep. America is the only country in the history of the entire world where one race of people fought to free another race of people. The Civil War killed more than 600,000 men. It maimed scores of thousands more. That individual liberty could be established for all American citizens. The rule of law, equitable, predictable rules that are stated in advance for all to know. Rules that are based on natural law. It cannot be changed at the whim of those in charge. Laws that are applied both to the governed and to the government. America has never had a privileged aristocracy. We've always had a meritocracy based on achievement. But the greatest essential of the American creed is God, or a recognition of a moral order that transcends humankind, that there is at least some power greater than mankind. God is the only authority recognized in the United States Constitution and the Declaration of Independence. The English author, G.K. Chesterton, said, America has the soul of a church. It should come as no surprise to us that America has been deeply imbued by religion from the beginning. Many of the founders of the original 13 colonies were clergymen. Religion has deeply influenced our country from the very start. Many Ivy League universities were founded as religious institutions. Harvard, Yale, Princeton were all founded as seminaries for the education of clergy. But freedom is not free. America and her ideals need constant defense. Ronald Reagan said that freedom is never more than one generation from extinction. It must be fought for, protected, and handed on to our children. John Winthrop, a founder of the Massachusetts Bay Colony, likened America to a shining city on a hill, a beacon of liberty shining for all to see. Now that beacon still shines today. Think, if you will, of the Statue of Liberty standing in New York Harbor, majestically lifting her lamp of freedom high above the horizon for all the world to see. America, our country, is a noble, fair-minded country. We are always willing to right injustice and to embrace all our citizens as equal before the law. Next 4th of July is the 236th anniversary of the founding of our country. On that morning, let's all get up, reflect on how privileged we are to live in this great country. And along with my daughters, and now 5 granddaughters, let's all say, Happy Birthday, America. Mr. Toastmasters.
Thank you, Hugh Dunbar, and 1 minute silence, please, for our judges. Thank you, Mr. Tanger. Our next speaker, speaker number 3, Greg Thompson. That thing. That thing, Greg Thompson.
Successful people are people of action. They know how to get things done, and they do it. Dreams and goals have to be put into action before they can ever be realized. Will Rogers once said, even if you're on the right track, you're still going to get run over if you just sit there. Mr. Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, friends, and guests, in order to embrace and enjoy the success for which you were born, it is critically important that you, as well as I, learn to become self-starters. That means we must decide and determine to be people of action. Success in life is achieved by doing. Tragically, there are very few people who have mastered the internal motivation to be self-starters. I read one time a statement that said, if more husbands were self-starters, fewer wives would be cranks. And the rest of you will get that on the way home. Here's the truth. If we are not diligent, we all tend to settle into a rut. It's easy to settle into a rut. Let me ask you a question. Are you in a rut? Some ruts are so powerful that we can be in them and not realize it. We cannot take ruts lightly, because if you stay in one long enough, it can turn into a grave. The only difference between a rut and a grave is how deep it is and how long you're in it. I have 3 rules for ruts. Rule number 1, stop digging. Let me give you a few examples of how to tell if you may be in a rut. If you compare yourself to others, rather than comparing yourself to the best possible version of yourself, you might be in a rut. If you are comfortable living a life filled with unrealized goals, if you spend more time varnishing the past than constructing the future, if average has become acceptable to you, and you have settled for a good life because you have given up on ever having a great life, you're probably in a rut. If you spend most of your time watching others live out their dreams on television and in tabloids, then you are pursuing your own ambitions and aspirations. If you find yourself constantly playing the victim, looking for someone to side with you and feel sorry for you, you're probably in a rut. Let me go a bit further. If you haven't made a big mistake lately, you're probably in a rut. Because you stopped playing to win and instead played your playing not to lose. Just about the time you were within striking distance of something feeling great, you let up and break your own momentum. That's a rot. If no one is blocking your path from greater things and a greater life, if no one is hating on your activity, if no one is jealous of you, if no one is lying on you, if no one is talking about you, you are definitely in a rut. Is there anyone here today who knows of someone who is possibly in a rut? I was in a rut. I became comfortable. Each one of those examples were once me in my life. So if you know of someone, or perhaps you are that someone who has settled like me unwittingly into a rut, I've got some great news for you. You can break out. Yes, you can. Just like me. Today is a good day to break out and set new goals. And guess what? Age doesn't matter, Dietmar. What does it matter to live a long time if you don't do anything with your life? The only thing that matters is now. It's never too late to stop. Hear me. No one can get you out of your rut if you are determined to stay in it. Conversely, no one can keep you in the rut once you've made up your mind you are coming out. Rule number two to ruts is we must accept responsibility for our own life. Don't blame anyone else. Because if you are unhappy, you are unhappy. We love to project on others what's true of us. And finally, rule number three, we don't wait for ideal circumstances. If you want to do something, sometimes you have to do it in less than favorable circumstances. So many of us believe if we cannot do something perfectly, we should not do it at all. For example, say it with me. Practice makes
perfect.
No, it doesn't. Practice makes improvement. Poet and author Burton Braley once said, and I paraphrase, if you want something bad enough, you go out and fight for it. You work day and night for it. You give up your time, your peace, and your sleep for it. If all that you dream and scheme is about it, and life seems useless, worthless without it. If you gladly sweat for it, fret for it, and plan for it, lose all fear of the opposition for it. If you simply go after that thing that you want, with all your capacity, strength and sagacity, faith, hope, confidence, and stern pertinacity. If neither cold, poverty, famine nor gout, sickness nor pain of body and brain can keep you away from that thing that you want, if dogged and grin you beseech and beset it, with the help of God, I declare you will get it. That thing is your heart's desire. Successful people take action. So get out of your rut and get your lives moving. Now you know what that thing is, Mr. Toastmaster.
Okay. 1 minute, please, for our judges. Thank you, Mr. Tyler. Our next contestant, Gary Behrens, stand up. Stand up, Gary Behrens.
Thank you, Mr. Toastmaster. Fellow Toastmasters and distinguished guests, remember high school? For some, it was probably a blast from start to finish. For most, it was a time of awkwardness and adjustment. Yet, we survived fairly well. For a few, it was a time of alienation and isolation. They were the ones who got teased and picked on. In other words, it was the pit. Yes, we all saw it, didn't we? It was bullying then, and it's bullying now. I'd like to share an experience from high school that I hope can change our perspectives towards the mentality of bullying. It was in 10th grade. Popular kids were Jerry and Bruce. Boy, were they cool! Everyone wanted to be their friend. The best athlete was Charles. We all wanted to be on Charles' teams in gym class. He was good at every sport, and he had a chip on his shoulder. I was one of the so-called smart kids. Kind of nerdy. I got teased sometimes, but I got along all right for the most part. Then there was Randall. Randall was the quiet. He mostly kept to himself. Much of the time, he looked kind of weird, but he wasn't bad looking, really. Rather, he was gangly and uncoordinated. He didn't seem too swift either, if you know what I mean. Typically, his homework wasn't ready to hand in. He couldn't give a decent answer in class to save his life. You get the picture, right? Loser! Of course, Randall got teased and harassed a lot. I can't say that I did razz him sometimes, too. Mostly, though, I just ignored him. To me, he was a doofus. I didn't want to associate with a doofus. No way. One day, though, something happened that changed my outlook. It was right after school, on a warm spring day. Gym class was our final period. We had been playing soccer, so we were all pretty sweaty. There were two showers in the locker room. If you weren't one of the first kids back, you were going to have a cold shower. Naturally then, it wasn't unusual for guys to just get dressed and leave. After all, it was the last class of the day. Now, Randall's locker was over by the popular kids near the showers. On this particular day, I could hear Jerry and Bruce razzing him again. They were saying, "Randall, boy, you stink. Why don't you take a shower? Go in there, use some soap. Stay away from us." They kept it up despite his protest. Meanwhile, I got dressed quickly and headed out to the bike racks, minding my own business. No sooner did I get there than Randall stumbled out of the locker room half-dressed, with Charles behind, pushing him, shoving and hollering, "Get out of here, Randall, or I'll kick your stinking butt." As I was unlocking my bike chain, they're on the other side of the bikes. Charles is slapping him around, and Randall is whimpering. And that's when I got fed up with it. So I said loudly, "Knock it off, Charles."
He looked over at me. What did you say? I said, cut it out. Leave him alone. What are you going to do? He snapped. He took a step toward me. You want to fight me? I was a skinny beanpole. He was maybe 20 pounds heavier, all muscle. My fists were clenched, but I only said, no, you just need to stop picking on people weaker than you. And then I added, or I'll get a teacher. He glared at me a moment and pointed a finger at my face. You better not mess with me again, kid, or I'll beat you up too. Then he stalked back in the locker room. I looked over at Randall, who said weakly, thanks. Sure, I replied. Please, don't think this was a happy ending. Randall and I didn't get to be best buddies after that. Hey, he was still a doofus. It wasn't the last time he got bullied either. But not by Charles anymore. It doesn't matter. The point is, someone stood up to the bully and got it stopped, at least for that moment. More importantly, my attitudes towards the bully were changed, and I found the courage to challenge him. Now, I know that things are a lot different these days for kids in high school and middle school. Those with awkward physical abilities, weak social skills, or an unattractive appearance are at a greater risk of bullying than ever, it seems. As adults, we need to work at changing this situation. Yet it takes confident kids who dare to stand up to the bully. That depends on their values and their upbringing, which starts with the family. Please, talk with your kids, your younger relatives too, about bullying. Teach them to be compassionate towards those weaker than or different from themselves. Mentor them and monitor them too for any signs of bullying by them or to them, physically, socially, especially online. Help them stand up and stop the bullying now. Mr. Toastmaster.
Thank you, Gary. 1 minute silence, please, for our judges. Our next contestant, Prez Vasilev, When Things Go Downhill. When Things Go Downhill, Prez Vasilev.
Lights, I parked on a slight downhill.
in front of steam or so, leading to busy Belmont Alley. Mr. Chairman, Toastmasters and guests, have you ever done something stupid? I broke the first rule of flat tire changing.
Choose a level spot.
Friends, there aren't that many slopes in Chicago. But that night, I found one. Underwear, got out, opened the trunk, excavated the jack. Unused for centuries. Rusted piece of metal. But didn't Teddy Roosevelt say, do what you can? With what you have? Well, you are. Not a big deal. I can handle it. Loosen the lug nuts. Place the antique. Out the spare tire, shaking the entire car. I felt the car going down. Bam! The jack collapsed. The car collapsed. My lungs collapsed. Not a big deal. I can handle it. Just enough. Bam!
If at first you don't succeed,
just enough. Bam! The car had moved to the steeper slope. I grasped the gravity of the situation. The people across the street were looking at me. An audience! I was giving a presentation!
How not to change your flat tire?
I heard an inner voice. You are an idiot! Then another voice. Reach out!
I often hear voices.
Reach out? Should I involve the audience? Of course not! That's not my car. In the gas station store, behind the counter was Jesse, a middle-aged Indian. I did something stupid. Can you help me? My shift ends soon. I'll help. A man walked in. Jesse put on his jacket. Let's go. 10 years ago, when I came from Bulgaria, Jesse came from India. He looked at the car. I looked at the audience. It's his car. Press! That's stupid. But don't worry. I'll jack up the car a bit. You push the flat tire underneath. We reposition the jack. Jesse jumped on the jack. You never know who you're gonna find. When you reach out, I found a DJM. Distinguished Jack Master. Jesse's little act of kindness gave it a little extra height to put on the spare tire. Rusty Bulgarian hand shook rusty Indian hand. A friend in need was a friend Indian. Jesse changed more than my tire. He changed my perception of gravity. I felt a special pull. Not the gravity that pulls you down,
but the gravity that lifts you up.
When you recharge your pool friendships that lift you up. When you recharge your pool solutions that lift you up. When you recharge your pool lessons that lift you up. Is there something collapsed in your life? Something you tried to lift up on your own, yet things kept going downhill? Your awareness maybe limited. Your skills maybe rusty. But you always have the choice. When things go downhill, reach up. Reach up. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Prez. And 1 minute silence, please. Thank you, Mr. Timer. Contestant number 6, Barry Mixon. In the winter of 1992, Barry Mixon.
Mr. Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, and distinguished guests. I first came to Chicago in the summer of 1992, and by the winter of that same year, I was homeless. Yes, I was once homeless. I slept in cars, I slept in abandoned buildings, I slept in alleys, I slept in dumpsters, and if I was lucky, I slept at the Pacific Garden Mission, which is a shelter in downtown Chicago. And for those of you who have never met a homeless survivor before, let me be the first to tell you that homelessness is a horrific experience. It was the worst year of my life. People look at me today and say, how could you have been homeless? Well, what you don't understand is that homelessness is not an on and off kind of thing. You don't go to bed one day and wake up homeless, no. Homelessness is a downward spiral. It is the confluence of bad events. It is the perfect storm. I was fine. I had a job. And then because of the economic climate at the time, my hours got cut. So my bills started piling up. Then because I was the last one hired, I was the first one they let go. And then I got sick. And then something else happened, and then something else happened, and then something else happened. Until one day I looked up, and I realized that the sun just didn't shine anymore. It was dark all the time. See, homelessness is more than the physical act of not having a key that you can put into a door and live on the other side. Homelessness is the complete and utter breakdown of everything. Everything you ever knew, everything you ever thought you knew, mentally, physically, and spiritually. And it affects people in different ways. For me, the worst part about being homeless wasn't about being cold all the time, or never having enough to eat, or having to think about where I was going to go to the bathroom on a day-to-day basis. Nah, 14 years in the Marine Corps kind of trained me for that. For me, it was the loneliness. I didn't have anybody to talk to. See, I'm originally from New York, and I don't have any family here. And my pride wouldn't let me go back there, so this was it. I was marooned here like Tom Hanks in that movie Castaway. And what made it really bad was the fact that I didn't even think I could talk to God. I mean, how could I? It's not like I went to his house. And I certainly didn't read his book. So how could I ask God for anything? And I didn't even want God to give me anything. I just wanted to ask him one question. Why? Why was this happening to me? I did all the right things. I went to school. I graduated with 3 degrees. So why was I eating out of a dumpster and living on the street? I just wanted to know, was there some master plan to all this? Days, weeks, months passed. I prayed for insanity. Because when you're homeless, you remember everything you ever threw away in your life. That half-eaten sandwich, that cold bowl of soup, that old sweater that was just out of style. I longed for a bed, any bed. It's the memories that kill you. I was at a bookstore once and pretty much at the end of my rope when I stumbled upon this little tiny book entitled As a Man Thinketh. And in that book, it said that everything that I needed to change my life was already inside of me. That all I had to do is think about where I wanted to go and do everything in my power towards that end. And somehow, my life would change. And I don't know if I believe that, but what other choice that I have? I used to envy the guys that could sing and dance. Because I can't sing and I can't dance. But nobody wants to hear biochemistry from a bum. Nobody wants to give you a job when you can't fill out that second line of the application. You know the one that says address? But in that book, I found these words. Though your circumstances may be uncongenial, they shall not long remain so of you, but perceive an idea and strive to reach it. You cannot travel within and stand still without. Ladies and gentlemen, I read that book each and every day because I needed every fiber of my being to believe, because I was so tired of being here. I was so tired of the darkness. So, the next time you see a homeless person, whether you give them money or not, please look them in the eye. Remind them of their humanity, because they weren't always like that. Once upon a time, they had a job. Once upon a time, they had family and people that loved them. Once upon a time, they had a home. And if you ask any of them, I promise you, they will remember the day, the month, the season, and the year they became homeless. For me, it was December 16th, and it was in the winter of 1992. God answered my question. It was time to tell you this, because I'm not the only one. Anyhow, now all of you can say that you know me, because that is my story. Mr. Toastmasters.
you, Barry. We will now give the judges the time they need to mark their ballots, and we'd ask you for silence when this is going on. It may take a few minutes. Thank you. If the ballot counter, chief ballot counter, could indicate when you've all of the ballots collected, please. All of the contestants on stage, if you'd all come up in one go, please, and then we'll do a quick interview with each of them. So, Eric Fine and Deegan, Hugh Dunbar, give them a big round of applause. I should tell you that the judges did promise that they would book the ballot counters, and the judges did promise they would book the Chicago tradition, and each of them have promised they would only vote once. Which makes it less interesting, but anyway. Right. So our first contestant this evening was Eric Feinendiegan. Eric, welcome, and tell us what club are you a member of, and how long have you been in Toastmasters?
I've been a member of Toastmasters for
I'm a member of Lake County Toastmasters, club number 652972. Shout out to all Lake County Toastmasters out there and my family. Thanks for coming out. I have been involved for 8 years.
And have you brought the kids here this evening?
For the benefit of everyone involved, the kids are involved.
So what age are the kids?
4 and 21 months.
Right.
When you're dealing with two kids on the age of 4, you kind of get cobwebs up here.
Right. So any of them are future Toastmasters? Are they giving you any bad chatter about maybe your skin as a parent yet?
That's a great question because, like the rest of the contestants, you know, I was practicing quite a bit. And I was delivering this speech to my 4-year-old. And she said, "Oh, that's pretty good. Now listen to mine." And hers was much better than that. That was one of the most humbling experiences I've ever had.
Well, I would say that she probably didn't hear the speech you did this evening because you did a great job, and congratulations. And on behalf of District 30, we'd like to present you with a certificate of participation. Mr. Hugh Dunbar, I should tell everyone, by the way, that Hugh was probably the reason why I joined Toastmasters. I went to the club in Naperville on one occasion, and this man was extraordinarily welcoming and very, very receptive, even to an Irishman with a bad New Jersey accent.
So it's all my fault.
So, right. So Hugh has been involved in Toastmasters since 1776. Yeah? But you were, one of your most memorable achievements, I think, is you were the chair when the World Convention was here in
Chicago.
Yes,
1999, we had the 75th anniversary of Toastmasters International, and District 30 Chicago was selected as the place to have it, and I was deeply honored to be chairman of that event. And that is, in my view, I've run three district conferences. That's why I was telling everybody what to do up here. Oh, and by the way, Madam District Governor-elect. But that event was extraordinary. And we should be due soon. We've had three conferences, international conferences here in Chicago. We should be due soon, I would think, in 3 to 4 years, Srinivas, about that. Yeah, so when we have the international convention here, we need hundreds of volunteers, and it's a fabulous event. There'll be 3,000-4,000 people from all over the world, and we get to show them our great city and the hospitalities of District 30. So
Hugh, would you say you've seen much difference in Toastmasters since 1999 to now, for instance, at conventions and things?
Yes, Toastmasters is truly becoming an international organization, and I was discussing it with some of the division governors. There's a significant change in the organization, all for the good, but we are truly becoming an international organization.
Well, thank you very much, and you definitely are a man for all for the good for Toastmasters. We wish you well. Thank you. Okay, we've got Mr. Greg Thompson now, and one of the intriguing things that I saw on Greg's interests is, I'm sure something that every one of you here is absolutely interested in and keeps you awake every night, is ancient Egyptian history. So tell me, how good looking was Cleopatra? Not that good looking. I apologize, tell us what club you remember, of course, please.
I belong to three clubs. The club I'm representing tonight is Broadview, but I'm also a member of Toast of Algonquin, and also AT&T Chicagoland Toastmasters.
All right. Thank you.
Do you find there's a big difference in culture between a corporate club and a community club?
Absolutely.
Right. Any suggestions or comments on either of those ones?
Well, it seems like in a corporate club, you have a captive audience. Everybody's at work. Come down. We have ours at lunchtime, so we have a pretty strong base of core members that come down every single week, and it's great. Whereas here, when you go outside of the club, it's a volunteer army. So I think I learned from being at a corporate club that if you greet people and treat them with kindness as they come to your club, they'll come back.
Good stuff. I have a question for you. Having commented on Dietmar's age, do you believe you've got a future in Toastmasters?
Absolutely.
I will absolutely believe it as well. But please, thank you. Greg Thompson, here's a certificate of participation. Thank you for your efforts. I didn't actually ask Hugh Danbor what club he was in, but it's two clubs he represents.
Four.
Four?
I'm in four. Twice as nice. We are Republicans. Naperville Toastmasters and Hinsdale Toastmasters. I'm out of breath.
He's one of these Toastmaster judges. Our next contestant is Gary Behrens. And Gary, you write down that your interests include fly fishing and most music genres. Before I ask you about those, can you tell us what club you're a member and how long you've been a member of Toastmasters?
I'm a member of South Loop Speak Freaks, Club 7079, for the past 3 years, after a hiatus of about 8 years.
Right. And I have questions for you. Have you actually seen the movie Bully, the one that has just been released about bullying?
No, I haven't. But it was one of the things that was brought to my attention that led to my reminiscing about my experience that led to the speech.
Right, well, I thought you had an excellent message. Now, I know I can say that after because the judges have done the judging and things like that. But I have a question for you about fly fishing and most music genres. My favorite band is Metallica, right? And I hear that if you actually play Metallica loud, fish actually just jump out of the...
well, to begin with, I'm not a fan of Metallica. That's one genre.
Okay, next question.
I will say this though. Fly fishing is as humbling, if not more humbling, than golf. I'm not a golfer, but it is humbling when a small fish can outsmart you. And I've had that experience many times.
And it's also a very kind of calming exercise, isn't
yes,
it?
Yes, it is. It's a lonesome, calming experience to be out in the stream and out in the middle of nowhere. I enjoy it.
Right, well, hopefully you don't feel that lonesome here this evening, and here is a certificate of participation. Gary, thank you. Thank you. Our next contestant is Prez, and I've met Prez over the last couple of years. Prez, I have one question for you. Well, I'll ask the question. Is there any club in District 30 you are not a member of? So which club are you actually
representing? 7880 Toastmasters of Lincoln Park. Let me see some hands. Okay, great. I'm also a member of Windy City Professional Speakers. I see Stan over there. Raise the hands. Okay. Unity Toastmasters. There you go.
Okay, we got to finish up tonight sometime. one of the things that intrigued me about your speech is that can you give us a lesson in how you were able to make that kind of cranky noise, okay? We're trying to get everyone here in the audience to do it once.
Here's the lesson. Practice makes...
So how do you make the noise? We get everyone to do it. Can we try it once from everyone? You're going to need a lot of practice. Prez, you came from Bulgaria how long ago?
10 years ago.
10 years ago.
When Jesse came.
Right. Okay. How much of a challenge was it to come into the United States? And
yes, it was a challenge because I don't have any family members here, but I have found my family. Yeah. It's all around me. That's all. So.
Member of our family as well. And Prez, we'd like to provide you with a certificate of participation. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom.
And our final contestant is Barry Mixon. Barry, you say your interests include great movies. So, what would you say your favorite movie would be?
It's Star Wars. Let me take this opportunity to say why I like Star Wars. It's not the characters. One of the things that happens when you're homeless, you're very angry. I identify with Darth Vader. I know, I'm serious. I know what it feels like to have that level of rage inside of you. And one of the greatest things that's happened to me in the 3 years, 4 months, and 21 days I've been a part of Toastmasters is I've had a chance to really find peace within inside myself. And that's why I wanted to do this speech, because this is my 20th anniversary of being homeless. And to be able to do that speech here in front of all these people, which I would have been invisible to you 20 years ago. And I'm honored to be able to finally be able to say that. And so it's not so, that's what Star Wars, for those of you who think I just walk around with a lightsaber all day long, it's really Darth Vader. Notice the black, I still have some parts.
Which club were you actually representing this evening?
Toast of Al Gandhi.
And was that the club that you joined? Was that your first Toast?
No, that's my sixth club. I literally travel 120 miles to get to the home of the Jedi.
Good. All right, are you traveling the Star Wars flyer or what?
With gas prices, I can't afford it.
All right. Well, Barry, we'd like to present you with a certificate of participation. We appreciate your contribution this evening. Thank you. Give them all one giant round of applause again. Each of the contestants this evening did a fabulous job. I understand that we'll be bringing Patrick Stevenson back up, and he will go through the rest of the events for this evening, and I will see you later on. Have a great dinner, and again, thank you for everything.
Ladies and gentlemen, is Connor great or what? Through this wonderful contest. Thank you very much. And for giving us an hilarious warm-up before Connor. It's hard to be on the same stage with Connor and get as many laughs, but this lady did it. Melody, come on up. Well, stay tuned. The winners of this event are coming a little later this evening. And speaking of this evening, we have dinner in the same room at 6 o'clock sharp. If you are eating dinner and you don't have a bracelet, make sure you check with the registration desk. Only people with bracelets will be able to sit at the tables for dinner. If you're sitting at the head table, our distinguished elected officers, we're going to be aligning for the procession outside these doors at 5:45. And also, you do see that we videotape these contests and the conference. So if you're interested in DVD, speak with Mr. Tim Bolger sometime before the evening is over. We have until 6 o'clock, ladies and gentlemen, to get changed or get freshened up. Thank you for coming, and we'll see you at dinner time.